our next speaker, final speaker here in the garage, will outline some defense strategies we can use to mitigate this threat. So let's welcome Guglielmo Iozia, Associate Director at MSD. Hi, how are you?
Hi, Nicholas. Hi, everyone. So first of all, let me say thank you to the organizers as well, because they are doing a tremendous work. I know it's really challenging to do this presentation, this event as virtual. So thank you again, and thanks for this opportunity.
All right, take it away. The stage is yours.
Sure, thank you. Okay, let me share my presentation. Okay. Okay, it's coming up.
I'll let you know when we see it.
Can you see it?
Not yet, I'll let you know.
It came up?
No, can you put it in full screen?
Let me try. Let me try again to share this. Okay, can you see it?
Is it on full screen?
No, it's for some reason doesn't go to full screen. We did the test before.
We're not seeing it yet.
Oh.
Which in a presentation about perception is a bit ironic.
Yeah, it's a...
Or maybe this is part of it. You're just no, building the suspense.
Yeah. Let me try now. Now, for some reason, doesn't come up into the screen. Let me just close it. Oh, that's weird. We did the test a few minutes ago.
Okay. Would you like us to take a minute break and you can try with the technicians to fix that and we'll come back?
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Okay. So we'll be back in a couple of minutes, hopefully with this small technical issue sorted. Okay, we're back. We're crossing fingers here. Okay, Guglielmo, I think we're ready. We're not going to see it in full screen immediately, but we'll sort it out. So,
yeah, can you see the?
I'm being told that it's usable. So, go ahead.
Okay, so I'm doing this way.
Okay, I can see it. It's perfect.
Yeah, so I apologize.
No problem at all. We're ready.
Okay, let's start. So just a few things about me before jumping into the main topic. So my name is Guglielmo Iozia, and I'm currently am part of MSD. If there are people in the audience coming from North America, probably they know the company more as a Merck. Basically, it's one of the top 10 biotech pharmaceutical company in the world. And there I'm busy on understanding new cases of application of computer vision to the biotech manufacturing, and in order to understand if really we could produce some value for not just for us as a company, but for the patients as well, as the area where I'm involved is in the immune oncology manufacturing. I started my journey into big data and then machine learning and AI at Optum and IBM before joining MSD less than 2 years ago, and coming from other experience at FAO of the United Nations. So today I want to talk about adversarial attacks to in relationship to computer vision. Unfortunately, adversarial attacks happen to any kind of machine learning AI system, but because this is my field of expertise today, I'm trying to put the attention of this matter that is not yet addressed by the by many organizations. So it requires more attention. And by the way, to set up a defense strategy to mitigate the effect of an attack, it's really challenging. And the greatest challenge of all is to try to explain this concept in less than 40 minutes. So let's jump into the main topic. So just to have everyone into the same page, computer vision is the field that tries to set up some techniques or that allow machine to see and understand some digital content such as images or videos or live camera streamings. And this is not the future, is the present. So there are many applications deployed to production about computer vision. Some of them are within the perimeter of your organization, such as, for example, visual inspection or product inspection in manufacturing or medical imaging analysis. Some others are deployed in the wild, such as, for example, automotive, in surveillance or some other application with drone, for example. So they are much more prone to be attacked, to adversarial attacks. In general, computer vision nowadays, there is a big chance that is based on deep learning, which is a specialization of machine learning, which relies on deep neural networks. There are different architectures for neural networks, but today I'm going to focus on one specific, which is the convolutional neural network, which is specialized on addressing nonlinear problems in computer vision. But by the way, each architecture share the same concept. So there is an input layer, an output layer, where the results are produced, and a different combinations of inner layer. That's why they are called deep, because there are so many layers between the input and the output. And with reference to the machine learning, deep learning, so another challenge when it comes to, in particular, testing or security, it's on the nature of this new paradigm. Because in traditional programming, in IT, you have some software engineers that implement the code of your application, so that anytime you receive an input, then you expect a given result. So this is a very easy to test, to address problems, if any, to do bug fixing. But when it comes in particular to deep learning, it's a different story. So basically, the data scientists and the machine learning engineers provide the input and the expected results, and then through a learning process is the algorithm itself that has to learn and produces the logic. So that's why you often could hear referring to deep learning models as black boxes. So you can understand this is an extra challenge also from a security standpoint. In this slide, I prepared also a short video, but probably I will move on in the interest of time, just to show how an information propagate across a convolutional neural network. So the input images, it's split across the three color channels, red, green, and blue. And then the information is passed through the different layers that typically could be convolution layers, pooling layers, or fully connected layers. The input layer typically is a convolution layer, and the image within a given channel is not passed as a whole. all. So it's split in small chunks of the original image, and the process happens on this small portion of the image. This is basically mimicking what happens when our eyes see a new image or a video, and the information is passed back to our brain, even if then the implementation of the network a little bit differs from the mechanism that our brain uses to process images and videos. The last layer is always a fully connected layer that produces the result. In this case, you have a sports car result, which is the prediction for that image, which is in this case correct, but could have been something else depending on how well you trained your model. One concern that I have that I'm seeing so far in related to the evolution of computer vision system is an analogy I see between the evolution of the web that happens 30 years ago and what happened in the last decade for the computer vision. This was supposed to be an animated slide, so apology for that. So, but by the way, we are not losing so much content. So basically, the chart on the background is showing that for the web, everything started early in the 90s with the HTTP protocol and the first release of the HTML markup language. So that means that in time, there have been an evolution. So new version of the protocol and the language, new components have been added to build the web and related applications. And the outcome was that nowadays we have web applications that are far away better than traditional desktop application in terms of feature or user experience. The downside is that the more component has been integrated, the more security risks you have. But in the last 12 years about or more, there have been much more maturity from the organization in terms of applying security by design to web applications. And so there are multiple initiatives such as this on the screen as an example, so probably you're familiar with the top 10 web application security risks from the OWASP organization, which is always updated with the major security risk for web application. And if you look at your experience on dealing with web application in your daily life, it's now more frequent to find a web application which is affected, for example, from cross-site scripting or SQL ingestion problem, because there is a much more mature mindset for that. The same is happening for the computer vision, because in the last decade we have plenty of new CNN architectures, which are very powerful. Also, the evolution and the reduction of costs in terms of the hardware is making a lot of companies that are big tech companies, SMEs, startups, which are providing dedicated hardware for this, but there is not yet a standard awareness document for security, same as for the OWASP one or other initiative related to the web. If I look, for example, to back to the first time I did a talk on this topic, which was a couple of months ago, there was no real concrete initiative on this space. Looking, for example, at the ENISA website, which is the cybersecurity agency for the European Union, if you look back at their website, there is a list of the 15 major threats and related reports for anything which is IT, but there is nothing, no reference to artificial intelligence or in particular to computer vision. The only initiative that came up lately is a joint venture between Microsoft and the non-profit organization MITRE, which produced the adversarial attack metrics for security analysts, which address a lot of assessment that analysts have to do in case of attack to, in general, a machine learning AI system. But there are not yet still specific references to the computer vision, but it's a good start. So this is something that is a sign that probably something is changing on this. And so today, the goal of my talk is also to make people aware if you have a computer vision system, what could be the threats you could face, and what could be a good mitigation strategy for that, or a starting point for that. So let's dig into the main topic now. What are adversarial attacks? So adversarial attacks could be of the two different types. They could be natural adversarial attacks. So it means that this doesn't imply that there is a necessary and malicious intent on that. You see an example here. You see in this picture, there is a butterfly behind the grid. So there is no malicious intent. So it's just the case that the butterfly went behind the grid, and probably this is going to fool your recognition system to recognize the butterfly as something else, but that's fine, that could happen. There is no one trying to deliberately fool your system. Here there is another example on the bottom of a natural adversarial attack, where basically there is a malicious intent, because this is, was a typical action. I grew up in the south of Italy, and this was a scene that I saw a lot of times. So there were some gunmen testing their illegal firearms on a road sign. So of course, imagine you have your self-driving system or navigation system that spot that sign with those bullet holes, and that would be could fool the system, not recognizing that particular sign, causing trouble. So this, in this case, there is a malicious action, but not a malicious intent in the sense to fool computer vision system, but this could happen. Today, I'm going to cover the other type of adversarial attacks, the so-called synthetic attacks, where basically the attackers take some legit input, could be images or videos, and add some perturbation and produce an image which resembles the original one, which cannot fool our eyes, but definitely would fool your system. And so you can understand that this is done with a definitive and malicious intent. And I prepared some examples to explain this and try to explain why this happens for neural networks, where it happens, because that's important to understand how to do some remediation. So basically, consider these two images. So one of the amazing things of convolutional neural networks is that they nowadays have a high accuracy. So they are deployed to work also in mission critical problems. And the downside is that if you add a very little perturbation, the network could fail. So it means that could produce the bad inference, bad result. If you look at these two images, the one on the left is a legit image of a tabby cat, while the one on the right looks like the original one, but really that's is an image that I tamper myself using an adversarial attack algorithm, which is based again on AI, which is called DI2FGSM. FGSM stands for fast gradient sign method, which basically adds some perturbation so that the final image looks like the original one, but with the intent to make the system do a different prediction. In this case, I try to do a so-called targeted attack. What is a targeted attack? So it means that I'm not trying to make just the CNN, the computer vision system, fail. I'm trying to make it fail by producing a result that I want the network produces, so not just a random result. So in this case, if you look at the image on the left, this is a tabby cat. A tabby cat basically is still part of the tiger cat breed, but there are some patterns that identify it as a tabby cat, such as, for example, probably you can see this pattern on the cat forehead, which resembles the M digit and some others, such as the color of the fur and some the strays and others. By observing the behavior of the model to which I submitted this image, which produced a result, tabby cat with even if it's not good confidence, around 64%, but by the way, is the right subject in that picture. I observed also that the second top prediction was a tiger cat with a lower confidence than a tabby cat. So I directed the attack to add some perturbation so that by submitting the tampered images to the same system, the result was as expected. So it was around 100% tiger cat. So I reached my goal. And how this happened? So let's move to the next slide. So in order to understand why the model is producing that result, just consider that when you your system is subject to an attack like this, you of course you don't have the situation on the left, so you don't have the original image. You can just observe the image or a frame or a video you received that fooled your network, and that's the only part that you could use for your investigation. As mentioned before, deep neural networks are seen as black boxes, but there are several explanation techniques that could give you some insight on why the model produced that particular result in that case, so that you could also explain this to non-technical people, but also send this information back to your engineers, the machine learning engineers, data scientists, to use this information to make the model more robust in terms of accuracy and also in terms of security. This technique I apply here to explain the result is called anchors. It's some sort of accuracy rule-based technique which works on a local prediction. So it means it doesn't explain the overall behavior of your model, but it explains the single prediction. So I submitted the tampered image of the cat to the system that produced that result, and now I'm going to explain why is coming up with a tiger cat result and not a tabby cat. So this technique basically is has two steps. The first step basically generates some regions into the original image called superpixel. A superpixel is are groups of pixel on the image that share the same low level features, such as the color, the brightness, and others. Then the next step is to calculate the anchor. The anchor basically are the links between some of those superpixels, and the presence of offsets of the calculated superpixel into the final anchor tell us the information on where the model paid attention to produce that particular result. So you can see for the tampered image, which is this one on the right, the produced anchor is this one. And from this, we can understand that the model was still good at recognizing the subject of that picture as a cat. That's fine. So this is the good news. The bad news is that if I compare the same anchors on the legit image, I can see that there is something missing here. So because this was a targeted attack, so definitely the model couldn't recognize the cat as a tabby cat, but as a tiger cat. And the missing part, so the model now, here on the right, is not paying attention anymore to an important information on the original image, which is the forehead pattern of the cat. So that's why it's producing that particular result. Now, I understand this is a silly example, but imagine happening the same in some autonomous driving system or some biometric surveillance system, because these techniques work on any computer vision system. And in a couple of slides, you will understand why. So this is important, and could cause serious consequences in the real world. So let's move to the next example. In this, let me just move this up here. Supposed to be some animation. So on this is another interesting example. It was really hard to prepare for this presentation because I have to first pick up some wake model to CNN model to do this, and then pick up some image that could fool that particular model. Typically, when you train your deep learning model, you prepare some meaningful data set for training and validation, of course, of the model, and try to have some meaningful images for it. Imagine in this case, that was a model that should be able to recognize cars, different kind of cars, and also other vehicles and objects. So I pick up this image from the web. You can see, okay, this looks a very nice image of a Volkswagen Beetle. So it would be good to train the model. And also, I expect if I submit this image to have the proper result for the model. So I discovered that by submitting the legit image, the model wasn't really good. So it produced a result that is totally wrong with this. But that's fine. That's another problem. The interesting thing is that when I start performing an adversarial attack, I found this result. So the final outcome of the model, in this case, it wasn't a targeted attack. So my goal here was to just fool the model to produce something else. And you can see that, by the way, the result changed. It's 99% convertible. And it is interesting because the original image also contains some natural adversarial attack. So probably you don't know if you already spotted it, but if I move to the next slide, you will see that this is a combined attack, a synthetic and natural attack. So it means that in this case, looking at the same, applying the same techniques, the anchor techniques here, this is the produced result. I could ask you not paying too much attention on the image on the left for one reason, because these anchor techniques has been proven that is very effective on explaining the outcome of a prediction in those cases where the model produces a result with a high confidence. So typically, if it's around 89-90% or more, but in some cases also after 70%. So you saw from this prediction, it produces just 45% confidence. So the result of the anchor should not be taken into great consideration. But for the adversarial sample, we saw that the confidence was 99% recognizing this as a convertible car. Looking at the produced anchor, you will see that the model is paying attention to some super pixels that really resemble this as a car, because this is definitely is a car, but is not a convertible car. So did you spot now where the natural adversarial attack is? So because this car comes with a luggage rack on top of the this is projecting a shadow on the top of the car, and so this is the model is paying attention, among other things, to this super pixel, and this is fooling the model, say, okay, to me this is a convertible car, which is not, because it's just the shadow of the luggage rack on that. And this is something that, by the way, is you have to consider, not just to defend your make your model more robust from adversarial attacks, but also for the overall accuracy of your model, because in this case, for this particular super pixel, there was no malicious intent. But by the way, that information is contained there. So it's the case that you go back to train the model in a different way. By the way, this wasn't a good model because it was misbehaving for some other result. So at this stage, if I come back to the original example of the cat, so probably you're still asking, but why my eyes are still seeing a tabby cat in that picture, same as the adversarial sample, and the model is producing a different result. So in order to understand the weakness, we have to go back to the training process for deep learning. So what happens? So this basically is an iterative process. You typically prepare your dataset for training and validation. Images are passed as inputs to the model. This information flows through the different layers. And then the model for that particular input produces a prediction. The predicted value, along with the expected value, are passed an input to the loss function, which, along with the optimizer, are the other two important components of a convolutional neural network, that basically produces a score, which is called a loss score, that is sent back as input to the optimizer, that needs to use this information to update the weights of the learnable parameters of the model. So this is the process that happens. The goal of the optimizer is to minimize the loss as much as possible to improve the performance of the model. Can you spot the weakness on this slide now? So basically, the problem is that the gradients are backpropagated to update the network learnable parameters only, but there is no action, no gradient calculation for the input data. So it means that as an external attacker, just updating a little bit the input data is possible to maximize the loss for the predicted result, and which should be closer to the true prediction. And at the same time, in the case in particular of targeted attack, is to minimize the loss for a different prediction. This basically doesn't touch too much the semantic characteristic of the original image. So the tabicat is still tabicat, a car is still a car, but the produced result will be something else, but your eyes will still see the subject as for in the original image. So this is where the weakness is. Forgot to mention before that in this conversation, I'm considering a situation where your computer vision system, and so your model, is within a very robust security perimeter. So it means that as an attacker, I don't have any way to reach the model. Otherwise, in that case, it would be much more easier to tamper with the model. I'm not a professional hacker, but I know at least a dozen ways to tamper with a model if I could get my hands on the serialized model. So the only way for an attacker to fool the system is to manipulate the input images. As you can see, by working on this mechanism, I can have some way to do this. So this is a weakness that is in the nature itself of convolutional neural networks, but there are different ways to put remediation to this, how to make your network and your computer vision more robust. First, I have to do mention about the typologies of attacks. There are two main families, single step or iterative. Single step means that there is just a single step of gradient computation on the input data. And this is the kind of attack which has the better transferability. So it means that whatever is the algorithm an attacker used to tamper with the input image, there is a big chance that the same sample, adversarial sample, work on different architecture. But unfortunately, this this is the kind of attacks that is the statistic has been observed is a less frequent attack. While in the iterative attacks, there are multiple steps of gradient computation to produce the adversarial samples. They have less transferability, so it means that the same adversarial sample, if it works with a particular network architecture, doesn't mean that would work with others. But don't count on this, because the landscape is changing. There are new techniques, such as the one I used, which is moving beyond this this issue. And this is where the statistics is showing the majority of the attack are made as an iterative adversarial attack. How we could defend our network. So there is one solution, which is the quick, not so dirt, that has several outcomes that I will explain in next slide. But let's go to the details. Then I prepare also an example at the end of the presentation for this. So one way is to basically, we don't want to touch our pre-trained CNN. So the training process for that particular application, particular problem of our system should happen the same way as it usually happens. So you're not going to touch the your CNN, but what we could do is that we don't directly pass the input image, whatever it is, if it's a legit image or adversarial sample. We need to put some randomization layer upstream. The first randomization layer does a very simple action. So once an input image is submitted to this layer, just apply some random resizing within a given range to the image. Then the output of this layer, before going to the our CNN, is the input to a second randomization layer, which adds some random padding to the image. The result of the passage across these two layers is an image which contains the selection of those two random selected patterns, which has the effect to remove most part of the perturbation that have been added to the original image. And then this is the image that really is passed finally to our CNN, which will produce, in the case of legit image or adversarial sample, the same result with a little bit different confidence, but at the end, it will be the expected result for that prediction. This is quite simple, and I'm suggesting to start with this particular mitigation because it has several outcomes. For example, I'm pretty sure if you already have some computer vision system moved to production, you know that the training process is time consuming, depending of the particular use case, could happen in hours or days. And typically you don't just consider a single architecture, or you consider the same architecture with different values for the hyperparameters. So you do different experiment, and you know that the training process is time consuming and costly. And by the way, time translates in money as well, because you need some dedicated hardware resources such as GPUs or RAM, cloud storage for the data, etc. So in this case, you don't need to change anything or retrain your models, because we are putting something upstream at inference time. In terms of the inference time, basically, by putting those two extra layers before submitting the image, the added computational overhead is almost negligible. Or from the calculation, the stats, you can see that is really negligible depending on the specific use case or architecture. This is also model agnostic, because you saw we didn't touch the original CNN architecture for our system. So whatever it is, you can still apply this simple mitigation strategy. It has also minimal impact on the performance of your network. By performance, I mean here all the metrics you typically check to assess the if your model is ready to move to production or not, or what is the best candidate to move to production, such as the accuracy for each single class, or the overall accuracy of the model, confusion metrics, and many others. The test that we did basically show that by applying this strategy, the accuracy of the model is affected in the worst case in no more than 0.7%. So it means, for example, for a given class, the accuracy of your model is, let's say, 98% by applying this strategy, then the result will be no less than 97.3% in the worst case, which is really good considering the all the benefits you have by applying this. And last but not least, because the adversarial attack algorithm landscape is continuously evolving, you cannot foresee a specific strategy for each one of them, because you don't know which one the attacker or the attackers would use. So this is basically agnostic for the type of attack that at the end will produce the same sort of results. So some adversarial sample where there is a minimal perturbation trying to make your system diverge from the proper result. I prepare a small example here in the slide, or a real use case for a very popular and used neural network, the Inception ResNet V2. And basically, in this case, this is how this strategy translates. So you have your input images, you train your network, do transfer learning, whatever you need to do with your network, then start adding the layers. And also, if needed, in this case, it needed some sort of pre-processing in the image. In this case, it's a very simple pre-processing stuff. It's just resizing the input images to 299 per 299 pixels. Per three color channels, of course, because this is required by the model. So this is not a preprocessing that is needed from this mitigation strategy, but because this is required by the Inception ResNet V2. Then you set up the first layer, the randomization layer. You can stay in an interval of randomization, which is not too so far from the sizing of the input image. In this case, I'm suggesting for this example, 330 per 330, could be a little bit less, because if you just consider all the potential combination of resizing randomization, it would be, we are talking about some thousand combinations. So this is not convenient for also for an attacker to consider all of the potential randomization layer that has been put to defend the network. So this is an interval which is pretty robust. Then you configure, put and configure the second randomization layer, which typically from our experience came up that in many cases, just one pixel is enough. But I suggest no more than 3 or 5 pixels to make this pretty robust. Then the result of the passage across the two layers and the preprocessing layers is a randomly selected pattern for the image. And by submitting the original image of the adversarial one, the prediction will be what expected. You will just notice a little bit change into the confidence for that prediction, which is no more than 0.7% in the case of the adversarial sample. So as you can see, this is a very simple strategy that works. It could be, by the way, is an excellent start, depending on your needs. If, for example, cost of retraining the model just to make it more robust to defend it, it is not an issue. You could also do something else, such as, for example, retrain the model by adding those randomization layer as part of the architecture of your model. That's a good strategy, not expensive if you really have to retrain the model, by the way, or start with from the scratch this way. You could also perform adversarial training, which means that when you prepare your dataset for training and validation, you don't just put there legit images, but also adversarial samples that you could generate. There are different techniques or applying algorithms or to generate some random samples starting from the legit one. The downside is that this could have an impact on the accuracy of your model, because the model could probably overfit, having some issue, because we'll learn something from the adversarial sample that could be part of the legit images. So this is something that you really have to be careful the way you set up this. And by the way, you will have extra costs in terms of training, because of course you will work with more bigger data sets, and also have to do different consideration in terms of pre-processing, preparation, and the model configuration itself. You can also do something, some defense at the pre-processing level, which is good, and also you can still have the benefits of the randomization layer strategy. You could do something more complex by moving to variational autoencoders. I never tried myself, but there are several use cases and papers on that. So if you have a chance to work with that, just let me know how this would work. By the way, the message I want to pass today, and this is the last slide, is that from a cybersecurity standpoint, please consider your computer vision system, in particular the models, pay for them the same attention as for any other component of your infrastructure. It could be web application, network, data, everything. So because this could be a weakness point on your system. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this talk, unfortunately, this doesn't affect just computer vision system. So if you are some other use cases of machine learning AI working on different kind of data, there are similar problems, of course, then you have to address the mitigation in a different way, a specialized way for different kind of data. I know that many people from other conversations you had in the past couple of years have some concern of using AI tools for cybersecurity for different reasons, including also ethical concern, which I totally agree with them. We have just to consider that the same is not happening for the attackers, so they don't have any problems already using AI to attack our system, not just for computer vision system. So we have to start fighting fire with fire. And if possible, try to apply some techniques to explain the output of your model. Would be beneficial for you anyway. Also to understand the robustness of your model, not just from a security standpoint. And keep in mind that if you don't do this kind of assessment in the cyber world, at the end, that should be consequences in the physical world. So that's another motivation more to move toward a better mindset for this kind of issues. And that was my last topic. And I'm open now for questions. And of course, feel free to connect to the networking area in the Big Things Conference website, through Twitter, LinkedIn, or in the next month, I'm going to share some of the result of the code of what has been done in this space in my blog. So let's stay checked. Yeah.
Thank you so much. We gave you a little bit of extra time because we started late, but now we don't have very much left for the questions. But I would like to say, first of all, thank you very much. I found that fascinating, first of all, because I love cats, and I have one just like the one you showed there.
That's perfect.
Also, I am a photographer, and I spend so much time removing what you called perturbations, but what I call noise or grain from my images. So I found this fascinating. I would have liked to have seen some of those images blown up and enlarged so that I could see exactly what you meant by the perturbations. But it seems like these defense strategies that you talk about is a bit of a cat and mouse game with hackers. Yeah. So if you could perhaps just tell us briefly how you think attacks might evolve in the future. So how would hackers take advantage or move on from what we've been looking at already to create even more ways of fooling AI in the future?
Yeah, one thing that is observed at the moment is that, you remember I talked about two different categories of algorithms. single step or iterative. Now it's we are observing the birth of some algorithms that are a combination of both. So that is an extra challenge on, because at moment they are in a very early stage. So the result and the effects are similar to the existing algorithm, but probably this will change in time. So we have to stay really tuned on this. This is something that is happening now. What happens in the future, we never know, because of course there is evolution of computer vision algorithms, and of course, consequently, there will be new traits, new way of attacking them.
Okay, Guglielmo, thank you so much indeed. I'm so sorry we don't have time for more questions, but we're really up against the clock now. But once again, thank you very much for that amazing talk.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.